the previous episode, we were confronted by the auditor. We presented the basic definitions of MT, MD, MS, MP, and VA, gave a short introduction to general uncertainty, defined the difference between comparative and absolute measurement, and made notes on attributive devices. Here, regarding the type A and B evaluation, finally, for the first time, the auditor was on the same page.
The metrological insight needs to be translated into specific uncertainties first, and only then, using them as the type B, it can be used in the outlined evaluation.
Type A evaluation, as its tradition call it, is an evaluation of some components of measurement uncertainty by statistical analysis of measurement quantity values obtained under defined measurement conditions. Simply put, it's derived from experiments. Type B is an evaluation of a component of uncertainty from any source that are not type A. This means the information is available without the need to make experiments. It can come from a variety of sources, e.g. from a calibration report, from experience, from technical specification, if you trust it, and also from the MPA, the maximal permissible error. MPE is an extreme value of measurement error permitted by specification or regulations. This means that if the measurement system works, it will not produce an error that is bigger than the MPE. The MPE covers all components of the measurement system uncertainty, which generally come from the calibration error, the resolution, repeatability of the reference part, bias, and linearity. When the MPE is known, use it to calculate the measurement system uncertainty.
The repeated measurements on one master are aimed at estimating the repeatability and the bias of the measurement system alone. It should not be influenced by other parts of the measurement process, for example, the part variation. If the part is variable, let's say we measure a diameter that is burdened with circularity, it is a good practice to measure at the same points or to start the measurement from the same position so that the influence of the variation is minimized.
If this is not possible, the resulting values should be treated with the knowledge that they include also some components of the measurement process uncertainty.
The auditor starts to be careful. By now, he's realized there is more to measurement uncertainty than he could imagine. This is his opportunity to learn, and he knows it.
I know how to calculate the bias only per standard, but I was thinking if there are some alternatives. Do you always use the standard way?
There are several approaches how to treat the bias and the repeatability.
The linearity experiment estimates the bias at different positions of the measuring scale. So any bias estimated from the linearity experiment is as relevant as the one estimated from the repeated measurements. One approach is therefore to take the maximal bias from linearity and estimate a combined uncertainty of the linearity and the bias. The standardized approach is to make a linear projection of the linearity experiment to the tolerance limit. This is a slightly different thing, which also makes sense. In this case, we can immediately see how would the scale linearization affect the overall uncertainty.
And since we are at it, we can calculate the repeatability from the linearity experiment as well. It's just the residual error. The usual standards used for uncertainty estimation made many people believe that the reproducibility is exclusively an influence of the appraiser.
This is only true if the gauge R&R experiment is designed in such way. The reproducibility should be understood as any influence that is not just random repeatability. While it is often really the influence of the appraiser, it can be also the temperature, environment, gauge-to-gauge variation, measured object variation, and many more. Before doing the gauge R&R, always estimate where the biggest contribution to the reproducibility is coming from. This should be the observed, specifically calculated factor. It is not at all saying that only the biggest factor will be accounted for. The basic gauge R&R experiment is designed in such a way that all other factors will end up as a part of the repeatability without further discrimination.
It would be a pity if a prominent factor had disappeared in repeatability, especially when the appraiser influence is negligible and calculating it separately brings no value.
Wow, I always thought the reproducibility is the appraiser influence. It's just the way the gauge R&R experiment is done. I never thought that you can use the same technique also for the temperature. Wow.
The gauge R&R experiment should be fairly complex evaluation of measurement process influences to uncertainty. The measurement process is usually considered to be influenced by an appraiser, the measured part, measurement strategy including the definition of the measured feature, the environment, and the measurement system.
The measurement system is evaluated separately. The four other components, and possibly some more, should all be considered and, if relevant, present in the gauge R&R experiment. The experiment is designed in such a way that it is possible to measure several real parts repeatedly with a specifically controlled factor of reproducibility, as mentioned before.
The individual measurements should be mutually independent. They should be acquired as if it is a real measurement process. It's good to randomize them, but in a smart way.
For practical reasons, it is neither convenient nor desirable to mix the people. But mixing the order of the parts measured within each subgroup will do the trick. In this way, we will also check what is the possible influence of hysteresis, because the parts will enter the gauge in different order.
This makes sense. You can't find that in the AIAG MSA.
The auditor is having a mixed feeling. However, he knows the error of his ways now and is determined to learn.
There is so much more than just the standards. They are just a minimal subset of the competency.
He's a bit scared now, as he realizes the knowledge and competency out there is infinite and it can be grasped in a lifetime. But being humble and open-minded, he will at least do more good than harm.
That's it for today. Uncertainty is not a difficult topic if you think it through, and if you use adequate tools to help you.